Okay, welcome to tonight's event hosted by Kulturutvalget, or as we might say in English, Culture Committee. It makes it sound a bit more spectacular. This evening's talk will be about the ethics of killing animals for food. My name is Kai, and I will be tonight's moderator. And to discuss these questions, we've invited Professor Bjørn Torgrim Ramberg from the Center of Study of Mind and Nature at the University of Oslo. And also from the University of Vermont, we've invited Professor Tyler Doggett, who's worked and published on this topic and edited several books. Let's give him a hand. Before we start off, I'd like to remind everyone that this event is being filmed. So if after the talk and the questions round, if anybody wants to be edited out, please let any of us know. And we'll start with Tyler. Will outline the four arguments that are intended to demonstrate that it's not morally permissible to kill animals for food, and then Bjørn will raise some questions. Okay.
Hi. Thanks for coming and for being interested in this topic. Thanks, Kai, for having me and hosting me, and Bjorn for your contributions. And I'm excited to talk about these things with you. I'm sorry I have to do it in English. I told myself I would learn a word in Norwegian, but I didn't.
I'll teach you one.
Okay.
Tuck.
Tuck.
Means thank you.
Tuck. All right. So first, I'll say a few things to get the discussion going. The topic at first is not going to be whether it's permissible to eat animals. I think in food ethics, understandably, there's a fixation on eating, because whereas comparatively few of us kill animals and comparatively few of us raise animals, we all eat. And so we all regularly have to decide whether to eat. But at first, I don't want to talk about eating. I also don't want to talk about whether it's permissible to raise animals for food, as when you have chickens in your backyard or you're a pig farmer. And neither do I want to talk about whether, at first at least, about whether it's permissible to hurt animals for food, which is the normal way we do it in the US in the course of like normal farming practices. Right now, my topic is just going to be whether or not it's permissible to kill animals for food, as when you hunt them or when you kill them on a farm. That's not to say the other topics that I mentioned aren't important. I mean, I think they're very important, and they're very importantly different from each other. And I think food ethics would go better if we did better at disentangling these topics. And I'd be thrilled to talk about them in the Q&A. But what I want to start with is just the killing question, which is pressing because in the United States, and I'd be very interested to learn what it's like in Norway, but in the United States, we kill billions of animals every year for food. What should we think about this killing? So on the handout, on the tables in front of you, there are four arguments. There are lots of other arguments. In fact, one of my favorite arguments is not on the handout. But these are four basic arguments that I think are worth considering, even if there are other ones we should talk about in the Q&A too. First is argument number one, which is somewhat Kantian. It comes ultimately from some ideas from the German philosopher Immanuel Kant. And it's really striking for how entirely indifferent to animals it is. So the idea is that killing animals brutalizes human killers. And brutalizing human killers is wrong. Hence, killing animals is wrong. So basically, what Kant thought was, when we kill animals, that does very bad things to us. Like it hardens our hearts or makes us more likely to do very bad things to fellow humans. And Kant thought, oh, those bad things are what make killing animals wrong. He was entirely indifferent to the effects on animals. He thought those simply did not matter morally, except insofar as they had bad effects on human beings. He was totally indifferent to animals. Argument number two, by contrast, these are all in the handout, is not indifferent to animals. It comes from utilitarianism, the moral theory, which I think is the most popular moral theory in Scandinavia, not in the US, but in maybe especially in Sweden. Utilitarianism, theory according to which we're morally required to do what maximizes happiness. So in all, everything we do, we're morally required to maximize happiness. When we're thinking about how to distribute scarce resources, we're morally required to do what maximizes happiness. When we're thinking about designing public policy, we're morally required to do what produces the most good. I mean, even like the most basic things, like the position you're sitting in, you're morally required to do what maximizes happiness. About animals, then, a utilitarian might think something like argument two. Killing animals fails to maximize happiness. Letting them live produces more happiness. But utilitarians also think we're morally required to maximize happiness, and failing to do so is wrong. And if you put those two premises together, you get that killing animals is wrong. So basically, utilitarians might think, and in fact, some utilitarians do think, there'll just be more overall happiness if we stop killing animals. The idea is that humans might lose some happiness because fewer dead animals means less meat for us to eat, and lots of us are very happy eating meat. But utilitarians think all sentient creatures' happiness matters, and so they think any loss in human happiness is compensated for by an increase in animal happiness. And the idea is that animals will be happier if there's no killing of animals because they won't be living on farms and dying on farms. That's the idea. The idea is that living and dying on farms is just a total drag on animal happiness. Now, of course, some people are not utilitarians, and so they reject the utilitarian claim that we should maximize happiness. So argument number three on the handout is resolutely non-utilitarian and also strikingly different from Kant's. So according to this argument, killing humans is wrong. That's true. If so, it's wrong because it's wrong to deprive beings of a valuable future. Third premise, killing animals deprives them of a valuable future. But if so, then it's wrong. So killing animals is wrong. The basic idea that motivates this is you first start off by paying careful attention to why it's wrong to kill people like us, like unexceptional grown-up human beings. And you figure out why it's wrong to kill us. Then you say, does that reason apply to animals? If it does, then killing animals would be wrong. That's the idea. And so then the argument alleges that what's wrong with killing us is it deprives us of a valuable future. So what's your name? Yeah.
Elena.
Elena? Okay. Right. I know as soon as I asked, I thought, why did I do that? Because unless your name was Lisa or something, Hillary. Okay, Lisa. So Lisa, if you got frustrated during this talk and strangled me to death, that would be wrong. Everyone agrees to that. That's not morally controversial. I mean, anyone who thinks anything is morally wrong would agree to that. And then the question is, why is it morally wrong? There's this thesis that it's morally wrong because it deprives me of a good future. I'm not saying like my life is great, but it has like some good stuff in it. There are some good days. And then the idea is that when you kill animals, you deprive them of various valuable things in their futures. I mean, of course, no one thinks that what's good in an animal future is exactly what's good in a human future. I mean, for example, there are no animals at this talk. Animals don't make movies or enjoy movies. They don't drink and enjoy coffee or beer. But animals do enjoy some things. I mean, they have projects. I was talking about this with Kai and Eric in the car over here. I mean, they even have friends. And some, like, they have companion animals, at least, which give them pleasure. And so the idea behind argument three is, just as killing me deprives me of various goods, and that's what makes it wrong, killing animals deprives them of various goods. And that's what makes killing them wrong. That's the third argument. Fourth argument. This one has a series of scare quotes, which should be a red flag to you. First premise, animals are subjects of a life, which is a term of art that comes from the animal rights philosopher Tom Regan. And the idea behind this is animals are aware of the world around them. They have desires about how the world goes. They can feel things. They respond to stimuli. in a sentient way. Second premise, if animals are subjects of a life, then they have intrinsic value. That is, they matter, morally speaking, and not just as tools for human beings. They matter not because they matter to us, or they produce various goods for us, they matter all on their own. But if they have intrinsic value, the argument goes, then it's wrong to treat them disrespectfully. Hence, it's wrong to treat animals disrespectfully. And then the last premise is, killing animals is a way of treating them disrespectfully. And you put all this together, and you get that killing animals is wrong. On the one hand, I think this is the mushiest argument, because it does involve this idea of a subject of a life and intrinsic value, which I think to some people is puzzling. But I think it also is, of these four arguments, it's probably the most influential in the animal ethics literature. And the idea behind it is just, when you see what the nature of animals' mental lives are like, you see that their lives are rich enough so that they have a kind of moral value. And the moral value is such that it puts limits on the way we can treat them. In fact, one limit is we can't do anything disrespectful to them. If we do something disrespectful to animals, we're doing something wrong. And then the crucial bit at the end is killing animals is a way of disrespecting them. You put all this together and you get the killing animals is wrong. So there are a lot of interesting ideas there and in the previous arguments, but I think we can challenge every single one of them. And Bjorn will start to do that.
I'll have a stab at that. I want to say that it's really wonderful, a surprise, but a wonderful one to see that so many of you have turned out for this. I think that we are experiencing a cultural change these years. Attitudes are changing, practices are changing only very slowly. I feel myself, my own soul is the site of the cognitive dissonance that many of us have, and I think that many societies have. So I'm also very grateful to Tana for coming all this way to allow us to explore some of these issues. I think talking about arguments is very important, but it may not be that arguments in the end are what decide our behavior in this respect. But it is very important to try and clarify how we think and feel with respect to this issue, how we treat non-human species. It's worth pointing out, perhaps, that in Norway we have a very ambitious law on the subject. The Animal Welfare Act of 2010 affirms as its premise the intrinsic value of all animals, and it extends pretty far along the list of species. So it certainly includes fish explicitly, and other animals that we might consider borderline candidates for moral consideration. And the law also requires us to take account not only of their species interests, but also of their individual interests, which is an interesting charge when you stand at the edge of a salmon farming cage. How's little Frank doing today? Seems like a pretty depressed salmon. But they're developing a kind of vocabulary for distinguishing the mental lives of salmon and the mental states. And there's a lot of research going on in Bergen at the Oceanographic Institute there on salmon depression. Clearly, stuff is in the works. The question is, what do we do as a society and as individuals with this knowledge? Are we allowing it to emerge? Is it affecting our behavior? What does it require of us? What options for choice are available to us? These are all, I think, hugely important questions that I don't have answers to, but that I'm very glad we're proposing together. Still, my job here now is to try and see what these arguments really amount to, and whether we can expand the way we think about these things in some way. So let's go to the Kantian argument. And maybe this is true, that killing animals brutalizes human killers. There's quite a bit of research going on possible connection between mistreatment of animals among kids and other forms of non-desirable behaviors. Right? But still, in general, is it really true? I mean, it's a psychological empirical claim. And so we might wonder about those folks whose livelihood involves taking animal lives. Are their souls more brutal than the rest of us? Are they less kind, more callous? My hunch would be no, but it's just a hunch. It's an empirical claim. I wonder my sense is that Kant was a little bit stuck for an argument. He had to think of something. You know, he didn't like the way his thoughts were leading, so he came up with this one. And anyway, as Tyler pointed out, isn't it odd to come up with an argument against or for the immorality of killing animals that really has animals' interests not at all in view? And I'm interested too in what we might mean by brutalization here. What are the capacities that are being stunted in some way? And what do you want to say something about this before we?
Yeah, I think the Kantian idea is, I think, that your ability to empathize is somehow being stunted by killing animals, but also I think your inhibitions are being lowered. But I also think you're right that Kant was just making this up. Like, I think all of, like, the empirical research Kant did was, he probably knew some kids who were mean to animals, and they were jerks. It's not like he's citing papers in psych journals that are substantiating that killing animals brutalizes people. I mean, I think there is some evidence now that slaughterhouse work is brutalizing, but that's actually not, as you were saying, that's not in support of the claim that killing animals in general brutalizes. I mean, you might think, like, working on an assembly line where your job is to shoot an animal in the head would brutalize you in a way that killing animals in general might not. Yeah.
But it's an interesting thought that these practices do affect us affectively and cognitively. But it might be, for instance, that the cognitive effects, if there are some, aren't really those effects at the edge where the killing takes place, but that there are cognitive limitations that we all sustain and perhaps contribute to by distancing ourselves from the reality that sustains our practice, right? And that might be a bigger problem than the reduction of empathy. I mean, empathy is a funny thing anyway. It comes from the German Einfühlung, which, and I think it's, you know, less than 150 years old, right? It's not that people didn't have what we call empathy before then, but it's sort of a recent invention. And what the psychological realities behind it really are is well, there's a lot of work being done, but it's not clear to us. One thing we do know is that it's pretty selective, mm-hmm. on and off over time, and also with respect to particular objects and so on. So you don't have to go far back into history to find horrible examples of how empathy can switch on and off. There may or may not be that effect, but it anyway seems to me to be not the direction we want to go to pursue this issue. I do think, though, that the social epistemology of these practices is very important. There's knowledge, to return to the law, the 2010 law, it requires us to treat animals in accordance with their interests. And of course, that's a very demanding law. As our knowledge increases, we realize that we're constantly in infraction, right? We're constantly breaking it. And the more we find out about the subjective lives of animals, the worse it gets. And so we could expect that there's going to be a great deal of resistance to taking on board what I think science clearly is telling us. There are scientists today who are agnostic about animal consciousness, but increasingly they're becoming a very small minority. I can refer you to something called the Cambridge Declaration of Consciousness, for animal consciousness, worth Googling. most very prominent scientists stand up and say, look, let's take it as a fact that animals are conscious. I think that's probably a wise stand rather than to be skeptical about it. Utilitarian arguments, I think, are enormously interesting in general because they seem so compelling when you have a context to them, when you have concrete cases. You know, of course, why wouldn't you do the thing that maximizes happiness in this situation? But once you start considering large-scale abstract scenarios, it's easy to start losing track. How do you calculate and compare different modes of happiness? And what's, if there is a cost, which I suspect there is, of every life, insofar as it takes up resources, letting some creatures live is imposing worse conditions, perhaps death on others. Right? How do we run that calculation? Do we want to bet our attitude all towards animals and towards animal killing on a calculation of that sort, which I think gets increasingly tenuous the more the larger our perspective gets? Do you want to say
right, I mean, it's that? Right. I agree completely with all those points. I mean, it does seem like when you're dealing with a really simple case, like, what's your name next to, not Lisa?
Jeanette.
Jeanette, okay. Right, so if I have three pieces of candy, like none of which I want, but all three of which Jeanette wants, it seems pretty clear that what I should do is give you all three pieces of candy because that makes you the happiest. And it doesn't, let's say it doesn't have any effect on me. I'm happy to give them, I'm just as happy to give them as not give them. So then it seems like there's just one person's happiness involved, Jeanette's. It's clear what maximizes happiness. And it's clear that I should do the thing, I think, that maximizes happiness. But in the animal case, I mean, just calculating animal happiness is incredibly tricky. And when you think about the number of animals we're talking about here, it's billions and billions of animals just in the States, I mean, to say nothing of what's worldwide. So one issue is like, how do you do the calculation? And then another issue, which Bjorn's bringing up, is then these trade-offs involved, like the happiness of one animal is sometimes balanced against the happiness of another. There's actually, this is an issue that doesn't have to do with farming, but like outdoor cats, like house cats, but that you let outdoors are a disaster for natural animals. They kill millions and millions of birds and mice each year. Their well-being, it seems, is increased by being allowed to go outside. So you have this trade-off in cat happiness for this unhappiness in bird and bunny and mouse happiness. And if utilitarianism is true, we should do, with regard to cats, whatever maximizes total happiness. And so you have to figure out what produces the most cat happiness, what produces the most mouse happiness, and then you have to do some trade-offs, because what produces the most mouse happiness is not going to be what produces the most cat happiness. But we have to somehow generate a number which sums up all the happiness of all the sentient creatures, which is incredibly difficult. I mean, in a way of bringing out how difficult it is, utilitarians actually disagree pretty strongly about what maximizes animal happiness. They're, like argument two, it has it that what maximizes happiness is not killing animals. But there are utilitarians who think that free-range farming, the practice of farming happy animals under reasonably natural conditions and then killing them for food, there are utilitarians who think that's what maximizes happiness. And then recently there's this interesting and, like, I find deeply disturbing idea by the Swedish philosopher Torbjörn Tansio, according to which factory farming is what maximizes happiness because it makes possible billions and billions of lives that otherwise wouldn't exist. And those lives are largely crummy, but they're like just barely worth living. And so if you have billions and billions of little tiny bits of happiness, those might add up into a huge amount of happiness. And so the Tansio view is that if utilitarianism is true, factory farming is morally required. I mean, you might think, some people might think that shows you utilitarianism can't be true, but Tansio thinks it shows you that factory farming is required.
Excuse me, let me jump in there a little bit. Could you both please hold the microphone a little bit closer so the people in the back here? Thank you.
I think that the potential example is a nice one of how theory in some cases well, it certainly is a double-edged sword, and as philosophers like to say, one philosopher's modus ponens is another philosopher's modus tollens. If you don't like the conclusion, you deny the premise, or if you want the conclusion, you affirm the premise, right? So, but what I think we find, many of us, is that utilitarianism, uncompromisingly held, will drive us to conclusions that somehow seem to us not right. Mm-hmm. If you're a diehard utilitarian, you bite that bullet, perhaps you even love the taste of the bullet. For all I know, right?
But no, he doesn't even seem to think it's a bullet.
No, exactly. Well, in this case, it just, you know, maybe he's a meat lover, and so the argument works perfectly. But look, I mean, it does have something to it, right? You don't want to, if someone said to you, so is there more happiness than unhappiness in your life? And you're having a bad time, and you say, well, actually, probably no. Well, then, right. Sorry, your life is a drag on total happiness and must end.
Right.
Right. It's morally required. Unless there's a positive balance of happiness, then it would be immoral to go on living because you're going to make things worse for the aggregate happiness. Now, that's a crazy argument, right? It can't be right. So then, since that can't be right, one would think that, well, even if a life is generally not good, if there is some good in it, it's still worthwhile. That's tenuous chickens. There is some good in them. And if you think that happiness is quantifiable as an aggregate size, then it seems we need to show why that argument, what the problem with it is. Yeah. I think we both agree that probably the problem with it is the assumption that utilitarianism is the final word on what morality is.
Yeah. Right, and there's actually, I don't know, do you know the show, the TV show The Twilight Zone? It's this American science fiction show in the 60s, I think. And there's an episode about free-range farming, but of human beings. And it's an episode that's supposed to show you that if we could produce more human happiness if aliens just came and gave us pretty good lives for, like really good lives for 20 years. They made sure everyone was well taken care of for those 20 years. There was no war, great education, and then we just mysteriously disappeared at age 20 because the aliens are eating us. And it's supposed to be disturbing, but you could also see the utilitarian logic of a situation like that. If you just keep on replacing people with more happy people, then it might be that that's in fact what maximizes happiness.
Along similar lines, the movie most often discussed in philosophy classes is what? Did anyone say Matrix? Thank you. Of course, you know, we could do that to animals. Right? We could feed them a little, or in some way like that. We could modify their genes so that they're content to be in cages.
Right.
Don't want to move around much.
Yeah.
Mink farming in Norway, right? It's pretty terrible practice, I think many people agree. But what if we could genetically modify minks so that they had no problem being cages, stop biting their feet off,
yeah,
and enjoy the occasional contact with feeders? But
right.
I mean, this isn't science fiction. It's going on. We're trying to make less aggressive chicken and pigs, or cooling it more.
Yeah.
All these things are going on. Not just through regular breeding, but through attempts or research into genetic modification. So if you're a utilitarian, you can have no problem with that.
Right.
So if we have problems with that, those can't be utilitarian problems. Hmm. There's an indication that there's some other kind of consideration going on there.
Right, right. Because what do you think, yeah, just following up on that, what do you think about this? One way you could deal with the problem of animal pain on farms is to genetically engineer animals so that they're insensate, they aren't feeling anything. But a different way we could deal with the problem is genetically modify humans so that we have no interest in eating animals. But there is a movement to like genetically engineer animals so they're insensate, but no one's modifying us, so we don't want to eat burgers. But on the utilitarian view, it seems like those should be both like equally good responses as long as they're both producing like the same amount of happiness.
But the argument leads us towards soma, right? The happiness pill.
Yeah.
And the little feeding tubes.
And there is something wrong with that. Maybe the last couple of arguments are beginning to suggest the kinds of things that are disturbing about this view of the utilitarian, that what matters is overall happiness. Because one of the problems with that view is that individuals seem to get lost in it. Right?
Yeah.
There seems to be no particular significance attached to whether it's me or you or us or however the happiness is distributed. But for many of us, morality has a lot to do with how we think of and treat individuals as individuals.
Yeah.
And what's often at issue in these sorts of discussion is, well, what kind of status as individuals do animals of non-human species have? And how should we think of them as concrete individual beings with subjectivity?
Yeah.
So let's go to the aptly named and labeled argument three. Yeah, killing humans is wrong, Tyler said, or voiced. And if so, it's wrong because it deprives humans of a valuable future. Yeah, and for many people, I think, thinking about death, what's horrible about it is the loss of what's yet to come, what could have been yet to come. So there is, I think, a lot to be said for the claim that what's bad about killing humans is that you're taking away their future. But what is it we're depriving humans of? Is it just a set of experiences? Or is it something we're depriving a human of here and now, in the present? They're projecting themselves into the future. They're giving sense to their life as having a duration, as being an unfolding narrative, as having a meaningful temporal structure. Maybe that's one of the things that's important about humans and one of the things that we take away. And so then we might wonder, well, maybe there are some important dissimilarities between ending human lives and ending the lives of creatures who don't narrate, who don't have a sense of temporal structure, who can't think of themselves as creatures on the way from something towards something, who don't have a conception of themselves as realizing ends of some kind. So if so, maybe that makes a difference to the argument.
Right, and then one issue that brings up is whether the first premise in this argument, killing humans is wrong, is actually not quite correct, and we should think something like killing a certain sort of human is wrong, like a human that has a certain kind of like developed mental life where they can project themselves into the future. And so if you had some infant that had some sort of chronic condition, so it was going to die at a very young age, but it was going to be very happy in those, like, I'm not sure when the sense of self develops and your ability to project yourself into the future develops, but I mean, let's say it develops at age one. That's probably too early, but let's say it develops at age one. So, and the kind of objection that Bjorn's sketching to argument number three, if you think part of what's valuable about, like, my future that makes it so that Lisa, gosh, now like in my head you are Lisa. Lisa's doing something wrong when she kills me and deprives me of the future is she's depriving me of like a future that I've projected myself onto. And then you say, well, this baby doesn't have that kind of mental capacity. So it seems like the reason it's wrong for you to kill me just doesn't apply to the baby. But you might think, then you might ask, well, is it wrong to kill the baby? And if it's wrong to kill the baby, is the reason it's wrong to kill the baby going to apply in the chicken case? And I think the last two arguments are both really about the sort of human, like implicitly about the sort of human-animal parallel, that they're both being driven by this idea that there's a deep similarity between human beings and chickens and cows, which is masked by the fact that some human beings, like us, can go to philosophy talks and can watch The Matrix. But it's not true of all human beings that they can go to, we can all go to philosophy talks, but I mean, a chicken could come too. They can't really get anything out of it. And so I think part of what's going on in argument three is that even people with like a very limited mental life, like actually, so by my grandma's a good example. She's 90 years old. She has Alzheimer's, which is this condition, it's dementia. She actually can't probably project herself into the future. I think that's one thing that happens with the kind of memory loss she has. And so, like, Grummy's life is just this like perfectly mindful series of experiences. She's like, oh, there's a puzzle in front of me, and she does it. Oh, look, there's a puzzle in front of me, and she does it. So, I mean, I have this incredible time with her a few months ago where she was looking at this coloring book for grown-ups. You know, it's a thing. Is this a thing in Norway? In America, this is a big thing now, coloring books for grown-ups. And so Grummy likes these. And she would flip a page and see a new picture and then flip back and had forgotten she'd seen that picture. So she was just toggling back and forth between two pictures she had done. But each one was like a new experience. She was like, oh, this is so beautiful. And flip, oh, look at this, it's so beautiful. Oh my goodness, Tyler, did you see this? It's so beautiful. Look at this one, Tyler. And so this went on for a good 15 minutes. I mean, in a way, like, Grummy is the best person for me to hang out with because, like, you know, I'm a very introverted person. I have to do no conversational work with her because she's just like reporting what's going on. And so this ties into animals because some people say when you kill a human, you deprive them of a valuable future. But what's valuable about a human future is stuff like our ability to think about philosophy. But in Grummy's case, I think there are these other values. And they have, like, Grummy can't think about philosophy. All she can think about is stuff like, look at the pretty picture, or I really like the way the sun feels on my face right now. And if you think it's wrong to kill Grummy, then it might be the explanation of why it's wrong to kill Grummy applies to chickens and pigs too. Do you think it's wrong to kill Grummy?
Let me deflect that question by plugging a book that I thought of bringing up. It's very interesting, actually, that you should. Here's the book. It's called Speaking Our Minds: What It's Like to Have Alzheimer's, by a woman named Lisa Snyder, who's worked with Alzheimer's patients in San Diego for many, many years. And the book consists of interviews with 7 Alzheimer's patients at different stages and her commentary on it. And the lesson is that we have a lot to learn about the subjectivity, what it's like to have Alzheimer's. There's an editor who suffered early onset, and it can hit different parts of your brain. But ironically, his language faculty was what went first. So they had some trouble conducting interviews. And he had to give up reading because it took him so long to read a line. By the time he'd read that line, forgot which line it was and he couldn't find the next one. But he knew that this was happening. Interesting. Right, so we need to be very careful here about what we conclude about subjective experience based on displayed capacities. There's a general lesson. Of course, I'm just plugging your case now. There's a general lesson here that we can draw, applying to range of human beings and certainly to animals, that when we think we're very confident that some capacity isn't present, we've often been wrong. Right? And so if we are wise empiricists, we'll generalize from this and we'll err on the side of caution. I actually think that this third argument holds a lot of promise and can be, I think, developed into something like an important element of how we should think about dealing with other species. But there's one other thing that's important to keep in mind, too. When we talk about the wrongness or not killing Remy or the baby, it's not just about her and the baby. It's about everyone who's attached.
Right.
Everyone who's a we that involves that person.
Yeah.
It's, I think, may well be the case that the worst crime committed against someone when you take a life may not be against the person who dies.
Right.
Right. And so if we're open to that way of thinking, that could apply in different ways to animals as well. There are all kinds of forms of attachments and communities and we's in the lives of animals.
Yeah.
They might be different from ours in relevant ways when it comes to considering whether it's, if so, how.
Right.
It's okay to actually raise animals and use them for food, but it's certainly something we need to consider. Did you have something you wanted to add to that? Subjects of life. I mean, this naturally leads into this question. Norwegian law has taken a good stance in affirming that all life has intrinsic value. But of course, that's only the beginning, right? What follows from that? And what does follow from that? I ask myself. You know, I'm a philosopher, so I tend to meta-reflect. I always ask, what are we thinking about now, and how are we doing it? And so I do this now too. What exactly is the nature of this exercise that we're engaging in? Are we working towards finding answers that are there, or are we, as I think, in the process of making stuff up? Right? We're in the process of evolving ourselves into a different kind of creature, perhaps with a different kind of ethic. Maybe, you know, that's how human rights came into existence, and pretty much a lot of the things we admire ourselves for. It wasn't so much that we discovered the right answers, but we committed to some good ideas and worked them out. And so that's what the law is requiring of us, right? It's here's an idea. All species have intrinsic, all animals, all life has intrinsic value. Okay, what do we do with that? We're still going to have to draw some difficult lines. We're still going to have to make some difficult priorities. And here's one. Let's say that all animals are subjects of a life, but there's scarcity for humans, for animals. You know, this isn't Eden. There's not apples for everyone to pick. And so we need to ask ourselves, well, is it worse to kill than to let die? This is a difficult moral issue that I certainly don't have anything interesting or original to say to. But we need to at least be aware of the fact that in a situation of scarcity, prioritizing some, however the policy is implemented, whatever the ethical standards are that we decide to live by, might very easily be to the detriment of others.
No.
This isn't a problem just for the utilitarian who's committed to the calculus. It is a problem, I think, for all of us that we have to face. So acknowledging animals as subjects of life, you say, well, that means we shouldn't end those lives. But the reality of our lives in this world is that we are doing that, not just through factory farming, in all kinds of ways.
Right.
So maybe the lesson is to do less of it.
Right. Right. No, that's a really, it raises this, I think, really hard issue about vegan production practices, which on industrial farms in the U.S., which are the vast majority of farms, animals have to die so that people can produce food on an industrial scale. Either they die because their habitat's taken away, or they die because they're killed by machinery or by pesticide runoff. And a pure utilitarian calculation about that's just going to be, you just figure out like how much happiness was produced or taken away by these deaths. But there's another kind of moral consideration that you were just pointing out, Bjorn, which is something like when a vegan farmer runs over mice in the process of picking corn with a combine harvester. The farmer isn't trying to kill the animal. The farmer's not aiming at killing the animal. Whereas when you kill a pig on your farm, you're aiming at killing the animal. And like one way you can test that is if the mice somehow get away from the combine harvester, it's not like the vegan farmer then is going to turn the combine harvester and chase the mice down. Whereas if you're trying to kill a pig and the pig makes a run for it, you have to chase it down. And I think, right, and so for some non-utilitarian moral theories, it makes a really big difference whether you're aiming at a bad result rather than you're just merely foreseeing this really bad result coming about. And so that's definitely a very important issue, I think, in animal ethics, because, as you're saying, it's not possible for us to survive without killing some creatures. I mean, of course, we have to kill plants. But it seems like it's probably also not possible for us to feed 9 billion people without also killing a really large number of sentient creatures, too.
Exactly. In Norway, we're producing many, many, many times as many pounds of animal protein through aquatic production as we are
All right.
land production. And it seems hard to imagine that we're going to be able to meet the food needs of the still growing population without exploiting in some way marine harvesting of this sort.
Yeah. Yeah, I was struck when I got off the plane today in the Oslo airport that there was a huge billboard that said seafood is the second best thing you all do. Do you know what the first is? Banking. It was news to me.
I didn't know this.
Right.
It's probably news to most of the people
right.
who are here as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
I still think, though, even though I'm not sure how to spell it out, I think that there is something importantly valuable about this argument that takes as its premise that animals are subjects of life.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems to me also to open up a very difficult bind. I'd like to hear your thoughts about this, because on the one hand, we know that we get in trouble once we start trying to home in on the quality that's supposed to be the one that's responsible for life having dignity or value or what have you.
Right.
Typically, it's been a way to make sure what's essentially different about human beings
right.
versus other kinds of creatures. And it's led to a horrible history of animal experimentation and so on. But it also applies to the way humans have treated each other. Certain human beings lack some essential quality Q, as we philosophers say,
right.
and that makes them therefore less important, less worthy, and so on. So the search for the magic quality, I think, is a very dangerous way to go. As Peter Singer says, all animals are equal, and there is a truth in that. But it's also true that they're not. Right? They're just not. In another fairly obvious sense, and perhaps we can't just ignore that, because some of those differences, and they are vast in the animal kingdom, between not just between humans and other creatures, but between some non-human creatures and other non-human creatures.
Right.
They're vast. Even to begin to give content to the idea that they are subjects of life, we need to acknowledge their distinctiveness, and that perhaps will also have implications for how it's okay or not okay to treat them.
Yeah, I agree completely. Right, I mean, one interesting thing that this brings up is, I think, the proponent of argument number 4, I think, and to some extent argument number 3, too, wants to find this one essential, as you were saying, this one essential feature that all sentient humans share with all sentient chickens and pigs and cattle, and then say it's because we have this feature that it's wrong to kill us all. And I think a really plausible response to that is that there's something essentializing in the pejorative sense about that way of thinking about things, and in the past when people have tried argumentative maneuvers like that, no good has come of it. But then if you want to insist on gradations between, say, qualities of subjects of life, then you're inching towards a view on which like some humans matter more than others, and not just like a normally able 12-year-old matters more than a 1-year-old who has a congenital disease that's going to kill her before she turns 2. But like really smart, like lovely, extroverted people matter more than really sad, shy people who have no friends. And so you wouldn't want to design a public policy so that you can, like, you would rank those people in terms of like how important they are. And if you had a forced choice between saving one or the other, oh, you should save the extrovert. But then I thought, oh, this came up because I was thinking about this on the plane, because on the plane, someone brought a dog in a baby Bjorn, one of those baby carriers, but there was a dog in it. And I thought to myself, this is sort of embarrassing nerd philosophy stuff, but I thought, if the plane crashes, will the flight attendants help the dog get off the plane? And then I thought, should they help the dog get off the plane? Like, does the dog have a complaint if the flight attendants don't help? And it seems like, I'm sure the flight attendants would ignore the dog, but then I thought, if they're going to ignore the dog, should they also ignore like the guy next to me who's clearly a jerk and is like sucking happiness out of the plane in a way that the dog is clearly bringing joy to people? And so I do think like there's a natural response to this idea that like they're subjects of a life, and then they're subjects of a life, or they're the people with valuable futures, then they're things with really valuable futures. But I also think this might lead us in like disturbing directions about how we treat our fellow humans, which I don't really know what to think about.
Yeah, that is a very, very important concern, and our history is not.
It's not encouraging. It's not encouraging.
So we need to take that into account, just like we as individuals in setting our ambitions for reforming ourselves need to be realistic about what we think we're capable of. I learned that from you. It's an excellent paper.
Thanks.
But it's true. And it's true, I should say. And also for us as societies, right, what we're capable of good and bad. But it may be that our task is to do some things that are in tension at the same
right.
time.
Oh, for sure.
You know, you just say no to differentiation among humans.
Mm-hmm.
And then we acknowledge that we cannot
right.
we cannot ecologically persist unless we make some differentiations
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Among other species. They might be difficult to make, but we might be forced to. And between look, for instance, we have in Norway an ongoing debate about what to do about our innate carnivorous animals, like the animals of prey.
Oh yeah. It's incredible to me that a country. I've come from America. I mean, the idea that a country would actually consider issues like this strikes me as almost unthinkable. I mean, you can see the state of like political discourse in my country. And I mean, the idea that you're even thinking about issues like this is amazing to me, and it's really heartening in a way that like discussions about 32-foot walls that Mexico is going to pay for is not quite as heartening.
Yeah. I mean, but the problem that the public relations problem that the United States has is that those debates are center stage. These other debates are going on all over the country. Right?
Yeah.
There are lots of intelligent people engaging in very intelligent debates that we can all learn from. It's just that they're not in the news.
I know. yeah.
So how are you to think about animals that kill other animals in this context? Should we protect them all? But wolves can't be happy unless they
right. Right.
eat meat.
No, I mean, there's this deeply disturbing view, I think, that if you really buy into some of these arguments against the killing of animals, then the position you should work for is the natural extinction of all carnivorous animals. Like this is a position that's been developed by the philosopher Jeff McMahon in a paper called The Meat Eaters. And yeah, the basic idea is that the same considerations that show it's wrong for us to kill a bunny, of course don't show it's wrong for a wolf to kill a bunny. Wolves don't do anything right or wrong. But we might still have duties to protect bunnies from wolves in the same way that, if Peter Singer is right, we have duties to protect bunnies from Kai. And this, I think this is like a fascinating newish problem that people who are opposed to the killing of animals have to deal with.
And what about inhospitable weather and climates? And
I know. To think, I mean, right?
Lots of animals die really unpleasant deaths as a result of natural events.
Right.
So maybe there's some kind of line that has to be.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I think we have to stop there, but we'll take it. 10-minute break, and after the break, we'll open for questions from the audience. We'll provide a list in front. Please write down your name and a couple of words about the topic you want to talk about. And but before we go for the break, I think we should give Professor of Philosophy Bjørn Torgrim Ramberg a big applause. And of course, also a big applause to Tyler Doggett, Assistant Professor of Philosophy, coming all the way from Vermont. Thank you very much. Okay, I think we'll start again. I'd like to mention that here at the Chateau Neuf, we have this tradition that When a person comes up to ask a question, we applaud him up, and it's optional if you want to applaud when the person goes down. And let's see, I'll be a little bit sneaky, so I'll start off with a question since I'm in that position to do so. And also, my question. Thank you. We briefly touched upon this in the discussion of the third argument. But my question is, if we consider Kant's second formulation, I think, of the categorical imperative, it tells us that we should not treat humans as merely a means to an end, but as ends in themselves. That means we can, in my mind, that we can use people as means, but not merely as means. And I wonder if there's a relevant difference between humans and animals such that this should apply only to humans and not to other animals. And I'd like to actually hear both your thoughts on that. Thank you.
Right. So Kai's pointing out that Kant not only had this idea about killing animals, according to which the only problem with it is the effects on us, Kant also has an idea that, morally speaking, the most fundamental duty, there's some debate about this. One idea is that the most fundamental moral duty is we're morally required to always treat people as ends themselves and never merely as means. And so, as Kai was saying, it's not that Kant's saying you can't ever use a person as a means. So if you go and order a beer, in some sense, you might be treating a bartender as a means to get you the beer, but Kant thought you're supposed to not only treat the bartender as a means. That's why you're supposed to be polite when you order your drink. And then the question is, does this apply to only humans? And you might think, if it also applied to pigs, that would be bad news for some sorts of farming, because some sorts of farming actually seem like they're simply using pigs as tools to produce pork chops, or using chickens to produce eggs. In fact, I mean, when you look at the rhetoric around methods of farming, farmers are very upfront about that they view their animals just as tools to produce different kinds of products. So it could be that there are other types of farming that do treat animals as means, but somehow also treat them as ends, in the way that you could treat a bartender as an end in herself. I'm not totally sure how that would go. Like, what would it mean to... I kind of sort of get what Kant meant when he said I should treat other people as ends themselves. I'm not totally sure I get how to do it with pigs. So that's one thought about this idea, is that it's not clear that you can't apply Kant's idea to pigs and have that be consistent with pig farming. There might be some way to treat a pig as an end in itself while also killing it. I'm not totally sure how that would go, because I don't know how you treat a pig as an end in itself. But another, I think the other more important point I would make about this is Kant's view notoriously has serious problems with human beings who are not rational. And so Kant thought the way to treat a grown-up as an end in herself is to respect her rational agency. And when you have a little child, you just cannot respect the child's rational agency, because the child lacks rational agency. Like, Grummy lacks rational agency. And so the Kantian view, if it seems like it's going to, if it seems like it doesn't imply that there's anything wrong with treating pigs as a means, because you might think the categorical imperative only applies to humans, it only applies to a certain sort of human, namely the normal grown-up human with fully developed rational agency. And then this leads back into these issues we were talking about, that it seems like the view might imply that it's permissible to do very bad things to demented old people or to very young children, which might be true, but would be disturbing.
Yeah, I think that, this rationalism, as we might call it, of Kant's, is a version, and is still, I think, living version of the attempt to say what it is essentially about human beings that gives them dignity and value. And for Kant, this is the fact that we can determine our own actions. We are, in that important sense, he argued, free. And because that freedom, that autonomy, is something that only humans have, according to Kant, humans are categorically distinct from all other species and deserving of a certain kind of recognition that no other creature is. That's his view. And it literally doesn't make sense for Kant to treat creatures other than humans, maybe smart aliens, right. I don't know, no creatures that we know, as ends in themselves. So that there is a reason why you wouldn't know how to apply that. Right. Kant would think, yes, of course you can. But you know, we could be more pragmatic about it, I suppose, and say, well, you know, any creature with needs and interests and subjective experience could be treated as an end in itself in some less, you know, super philosophical way. Yep. And should be treated in such a way that it has a chance at realizing those interests, and we help it along as best we can. And so there would be a gradation between a paternalist approach,
right,
and a much more sort of standoffish approach. But you know, we could apply it, I think, to pigs,
mm-hmm,
not in the Kantian sense.
Right.
Great. Next question is from Christopher.
Hi. I have several, one question, but there are several steps. But the first one is about arguments and interests we put in killing. That stems from, you talked about predators, like how we kill wolves. And the first question is about what values we and interests we sort of put in killing them. Maybe stems from like superstition and from like folkloric, like the big bad wolf, and it sort of transcends time. And and second question is more about how like we arguments about borders, like we have national borders and animals that transcend these borders, like Swedish pack of wolves and wild boars who are who are in Sweden but transcend the borders. They don't see the borders. But
that's true. So,
but also like trophy hunting and also all those killings and the interests and values of those interests, how do that regard to these arguments?
Okay, so all right. So the first thing you said is this idea about like superstition is super interesting. It is striking that the kinds of predators that are discussed as the kinds of things which whose extinction we might work for do happen to be these predators that have a powerful effect on our subconscious, like lions and wolves. And no one ever talks about like minor predators like, I don't know, octopi. Yeah, and so it might be that there's part of what's going on here is Jeff McMahon has a fear of, like, he wants to get rid of lions and wolves for some due to some sort of deep-seated psychological need, and he's just confabulated an argument that explains it. But I do think there's also a way in which the argument just naturally flows out of his view, and he uses these big bad wolf and big bad lion examples just because those are just very evocative predators, and they occupy, like, they fill a predator stereotype in a way that an octopus doesn't. And then, but then you have this other question about hunting, which is something, I think the arguments that Bjorn and I were talking about do apply to. You're pointing out that hunting brings with it all sorts of other values. And so one way to think about this sort of issue is, I was acting as if the four arguments are arguments that it's wrong to kill animals, period. But of course that's not true. I mean, no one believes that. The most hardcore vegan does not believe it's always and everywhere morally wrong to kill an animal. So if you're camping and a grizzly bear attacks you, and the only way you can save your life is to kill a grizzly bear, even very hardcore vegans might think it's morally permissible to kill the grizzly bear in that case. Or if like the grizzly bear is attacking your child, you might think it's morally permissible to kill the grizzly bear. And so these arguments seem to conclude it's wrong to kill animals, period. But of course that's not really what they conclude. They conclude something like, it's wrong to kill animals, unless it's justified in one of these special circumstances. And then the question becomes, which are the special circumstances? Self-defense is a clear case, but is trophy hunting another such case? I mean, after all, to some people, this makes a huge difference in their life. It's really part of who they are, that they are a hunter. In fact, I mean, in Vermont, the state I'm from, there's no trophy hunting, but hunting is a very important part of the culture of some people. And so I think these people think if they were morally forbidden from hunting, this would involve a great cost to them. They would have to give up something very important to them. And people say this about eating meat too. They say, if I had to give up eating meat, this would be an enormous cost for me. It would be hard on my family. It would be cutting me off from my culture. This would be a great cost. And so sometimes people think these kinds of situations are situations in which it is permissible to kill animals or to eat animals, even though other things being equal, it's morally wrong. I guess the way I usually want to test for these things is to just take the animal out and substitute a grummy. Like, you know, if you, your thing, your name is Christopher, right? If your thing were hunting old ladies, like that's, you know, it's in your family, that's very important. Like, it's been passed down from generations. Trophy hunting old ladies. And then you'd say, look, Tyler, I think, sure, in general, it's morally wrong to kill people, but there, I mean, you yourself will admit there are exceptions, and don't you think there should be an exception here? It's a very important part of my culture that we kill old ladies, and it's a way in which I feel connected to my dad and my grandpa. I mean, that would, like, just transparently be a terrible argument. And, but it is, like, it does seem like it has more force when it comes to elephants, but you wonder, maybe that's just some prejudice on our part.
I'm not supporting.
No, of course. Of course, you seem like a nice man who doesn't hunt old ladies or elephants.
Bjørn, do you want to comment on that?
No.
Next question is Åshild.
I have a question regarding speciesism, where you consider one species more worse than another. So I'm of the opinion that most people consider, say, companion animals such as cats and dogs, guinea pigs, more worse than, say, pigs and sheep, cattle, and so on. So the treatment that we put the production animals under would never be acceptable if we put dogs and cats in the same position as we have sheep, cattle today. Yeah.
Sure. I think that is a good point and a very good test. Many people have claimed that, you know, dogs and pigs are cognitively quite similar, and their ability to form affective ties and so on. So it's a good question. Would you let your dog go through what we let pigs go through? And the answer is no. You know, then we have some explaining to do. And we are again. This, I think, is an instance of the kind of collective cognitive dissonance that we live with. So it's a very good test that you put your finger on. But you know, we treat cats and guinea pigs and dogs too in a very, very selectively, right? People leave dogs in airport parking garages and guinea pigs. Rabbits, bunnies die terrible deaths from neglect. We have very little. So the empathy and the solidarity with these animals is quite selective, also, and driven.
I want to shoot in something there. My mother is a veterinarian, and she recently told me that dogs are more evolutionarily disposed to understand human sign language, or not sign language, but body language. And one might say that they are, as of that, uniquely disposed to be companions or human companions, and so, at least to us, and maybe also in themselves, have a more intrinsic value than, for example, a gerbil.
Yeah, that seems quite plausible to me. And one way of tying this into your question is a common idea that you find in the animal rights literature is that our treatment of animals is speciesist, and this is the analog for people who aren't familiar with that term. It's the analog of racism or sexism, but with regard to species. But then when you probe people's views about species, there's speciesism, and like your example was a great example. Like the way we treat dogs is just so different from the way we treat pigs. But then Kai's response to it illustrates a way in which people, when they're confronted with a charge of speciesism, actually have an effective response, which is you don't think it's the species difference per se that's morally significant. You think there's some other property that goes along with, that co-varies with the species difference, namely like the dog's ability to perceive human body language, thereby making them like a more fit companion animal. And you might think that's what's morally, like that's what's morally significant. It's not the fact that someone's a dog rather than a pig. And so that's like a common maneuver. I'm not defending that maneuver, but that is a common maneuver that people make in these discussions. And notice that like that's also what people say when they're confronted with evidence that they're racist or sexist. I mean, this is, I don't want to keep bringing up the American political situation, but when you confront people with evidence that they're racist or sexist, they often deny that they're racist or sexist. They just think all women, as a matter of fact, have a certain trait that makes you all less fit than us all. It's not that you're a woman, of course. It's that you're dumb. You know, it's like of course I'm not endorsing this. But like that's the argument. Then you're supposed to say, oh, I see, you aren't sexist. You're just like, yeah, you're just a jerk, or you have a really bad view. But you aren't sexist. So my response to your question was just gonna be, yeah, I agree with all that. But then Kai's point was there was a way of, I think, addressing your view, which is to say, no, there's actually no speciesism in play when you think about our treatment of pets and our treatment of farm animals. There's some property that the farm animals have that makes them more suited to being farm animals than some property that pets have. What do you think about that?
Well, I don't think we should define an animal's worth based on how useful they are to us. That counts for humans too as well. So, what was your question again?
So the question was, there's a way of responding to the claim that you made, which sounds right to me, that you can see a sort of speciesism in humans by seeing a difference in the way we treat, say, guinea pigs on the one hand and pigs on the other. And there's a reply that someone might make on behalf of our treatment of pigs, which is it's not speciesism. There's actually some deep difference between guinea pigs and pigs that explains why it's permissible to farm pigs, but not guinea pigs. I mean, of course, the guinea pig example is not a good example, since some people do farm guinea pigs.
Have you read any literature by Jared Diamond?
Yes.
Yes, and he brings up the points that they are like physically fit to be fattened up and be kept in pens and so on. But that doesn't say anything about their cognitive abilities. So, say a pig is, by many, considered more intelligent than a dog.
Yep.
So, you could say that by that a dog is more fit, and you can definitely fatten up a dog as easily as a pig. And they also eat like anything. So, that's not a cost. But that doesn't, by my standards, that doesn't justify factory farming any animal.
Right.
No matter what animal it is.
Right. Because your thinking is what's wrong with the factory farming is the effects on the animal's well-being. And it's irrelevant whether they have these other features, like they're easy to fatten up. In fact, like from a certain perspective, there's something horrific about thinking the reason it's okay to factory farm a pig is they're pretty easy to put weight on. Like that would just be a terrible justification for it. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yep. I just to add to that, of course, treating groups of people or groups of animals differently from other groups doesn't mean that you're discriminating. It's discrimination only if you don't have a good reason. And so treating pigs and dogs differently makes a lot of sense. It's treating pigs badly, that's the problem. Giving a pig a good life is quite different from giving a dog a good life. And we have, we have many tens of thousands of years of coevolution with dogs. It's a very successful parasitic relationship. They've got us where they want us. It works very well for them. And the amount of time since domestication began, whether it's us of them or them of us, who knows, right? It keeps being pushed back, right? Some people think maybe it's 100,000 years. The number was, I think, 30,000 something. And in that time, evolution does something to dogs and our ability to interact. So it's clear that dogs are quite, maybe not uniquely, but certainly very specially fitted to interact successfully with humans in a way that plugs right into our affective system. Right? If we get so attached to them, that's not a lucky circumstance. It's dogs' clever adaptation, well, not clever, but their adaption over tens of thousands of years. So naturally, we'll be treat them differently.
The canine conspiracy. But that also leads me to another question. We touched also briefly on this on with Gammy or Grammy?
Grummy,
sorry. That
Grummy.
Might be that why it's wrong to kill Grummy would be because of some external property, not with Grummy herself, but
right.
You, for example.
Right.
And that seems very odd that it's not an intrinsic property
right.
of Grummy. But
right. No, I agree. I agree completely. I think it, I mean, on the one hand, I think Bjorn brought out that we have all sorts of reasons not to kill human beings that have nothing to do with the victim. So one reason not to kill Grummy is like that would be devastating for me. And it would be devastating for my mom, Grummy's daughter. But those reasons seem like they can't be exhausting what's wrong with killing Grummy. I mean, in a way you can test that is to, instead of Grummy, just imagine some old woman deep into Alzheimer's who doesn't have any friends or relatives and who's about to be killed by a sociopath who will have no remorse, won't even remember, maybe it's a sociopath with Alzheimer's. And so they won't remember. So you think, would it be okay to kill that old person? You think, no, of course not. But the explanation can't be entirely in terms of the effects on other people, because by stipulation, this old person has no friends, has no family, and the killer, it's not going to have any bad effects on the killer. Right, so I think it's true that there are lots of good reasons not to kill people that have nothing to do with victims. And there are lots of good reasons not to kill animals that have nothing to do with, I mean, Kant might have been right that there's something seriously wrong with killing animals that has to do with us. But I think Kant went very badly wrong in thinking if it's wrong to kill animals, the explanation's entirely in terms of the effects on us. I mean, that just seems to be like missing something that's fundamental with the wrongness of killing animals, if it's wrong to kill animals.
Do you want to add anything on that?
No, I think that must be right. I think we can wonder about exactly how to articulate what the reasons are and whether they how widely they apply. But it still has to be the case that we're going in the wrong direction if we think that the reason why we should treat other kinds of lives with respect has to do with our fundamentally with our self-respect. Our self-respect is involved. But that's because we want to think of ourselves as creatures who show due attention where it's due, right? So that has to be derivative. The basic reason has to be something that's connected with the subjectivity of the lives that we're ending.
We have time for one or two more questions, if there's one. Yeah, just please go ahead. And, I forgot to say this earlier, but please keep your questions to 1 or 2 minutes minimum.
Yeah. Well, on a tangent, I have a question, but I think when you were talking about life being something you have to have a reason to keep alive or keep around, the idea of like someone being, oh, okay, you won't remember this, your life maybe isn't worth anything right now, so we could kill you. That normally is just that there's something that we haven't found a way of fixing yet. So with Alzheimer's, it would be, oh, sure, right now it's not great, but that's potentially fixable, right? So it's just technology or our understanding that's standing in the
way. I see. So even you're thinking, I was thinking the Alzheimer example shows you that you might be concerned that it's wrong to kill people, even if their lives lack a kind of narrative structure. And is your point something like, the Alzheimer's sufferer, life lacks narrative structure, but that's contingent, and they're actually scientific. There might be technological advances in the future which allow such lives to have narrative structure?
Yeah.
Is that I see. Right, and then is your idea that, so there's something to the narrative idea. It's just, you shouldn't interpret the narrative idea as being that it's permissible to kill anything that doesn't have a narrative. It's more like, it's permissible to kill anything that can't have a narrative.
Yeah, I'd kind of go further, saying that like killing anything is always bad, not because it's bad, but because life is a positive.
Yeah,
and
right, the narrative just seems
like
to be...
killing is a,
right.
It's a negative, it's stopping a positive. So if there's potentially future way of getting past whatever the issue is, depression or sickness or
right.
whatever it is, then...
Oh, I see. But then it seems... Then it seems like the narrative stuff maybe is not so important to you. As long as there could be goods in the future, then killing is wrong because other things equal, it's wrong because you're depriving people of those goods or whoever.
Yeah.
But no, that sounds quite plausible. But then, just like a little clarification about that. Is your view that it's wrong to kill anything that's alive? Like, what about Bjorn falls into a permanent coma? And so he has the lights are off.
Cryonics, sure.
But then...
Potentially. I mean, you've got cryonics. Like, there's a potential... like, it's not a cure, right. But it's a way to pause.
But what about broccoli?
Yeah, but that leads me to the question. Okay, so my question was, like, from our observations of the universe, you can see that life is a really rare thing. So the best way to preserve life is to encourage biodiversity. So when you're saying... Oh, what about carnivores then? Yeah, have as much biodiversity as possible and kill things as like neatly as as tidily as possible until we have maybe human photosynthesis, space travel, whatever you can do to spread life. Sorry.
Oh, I love that idea. But do you want to go first?
I was going to see if I could dig up that book that I talked
about. Okay. All right, so I'll go first while you're digging. Yeah, that's... I think that's a really interesting idea, and so that kind of idea is supportive of, is this right? That kind of view is supportive of the idea that it's sometimes permissible for humans to kill animals as well, because it might be in the nature of, in service of propagating life in general, and you're thinking that's a good that's worth pursuing.
Yeah, I guess just carry on doing it less and less and less, eventually you'll get over it and we won't need to. And then you'd be like, oh, we'll eat vegetables, and then, oh, well, we don't need that anymore. Like, you've got photosynthesis.
Right.
You can just stand in the sun. And then I guess you'd just be spreading, just encouraging the biodiversity. You have agroforestry.
Right.
So you can have, like, you can grow crops in a way that encourages nature to be as diverse as possible, and then just encouraging that always. And that's kind of what we're doing. Like, more and more people are into vegetarianism and veganism. It's kind of
Right.
Progression, the natural progression of
I see.
What we're already kind of headed to, I guess, is I optimistically hope.
No, no, I see. That's, you know, because there's this whole philosophical, historical philosophical literature about how in the past we were all vegetarian. That was Eden. And I mean, even like Rousseau thought this, and not for biblical reasons. There was this vegetarian past, and what you're saying is, and there might be a vegetarian future, but there's going to be some killing between then and now.
Well, yeah, that's something important. Like, yeah. There's still going to be killing until right. and, people right. do it less than
that. Yeah, and I see.
And it kind of evaporates.
That's an interesting idea. Out, yeah.
Well, but you think there won't be any human killing, but there will be other species killing other?
Well, I just following like the progression of human evolution, like our technology improves, our ethics improve, like our human rights, animal rights, eventually plant like rights, like just following the sort of natural progression. If everything continues to follow these curves, like of exponential like improvement, then sure, yeah, why not?
What's about animals consuming animal protein?
Yeah, I mean, until you, but then you, I guess we'd get to the next ridiculous step, which would be once we've become intelligent enough to live completely harmoniously with life, then you didn't encourage animals to become intelligent to the same level, and then yeah, why not? Sure, you've got the technology potentially in the future to live in this kind of like.
My gut would be that there's going to be a lot of violent death between here and there, and not just perpetrated by us. Right? I mean, when carnivores, when killing animals kill other animals, there's a lot of animals who don't themselves kill, and a lot of organisms. There's a lot of life out of those violent deaths, right? And they're very important part of the ecosystems.
That's just biodiversity.
Whatever we do or don't do, right? So this is one question that I'm wondering about. Actually, maybe you can also help on this one. Is human caused death worse than non human caused death?
I'd say just because of scale, like our technology gives us the potential to kill on such huge scales that nature doesn't ever have. I mean, it does occasionally, you get plagues, but in the general, like, nature doesn't kill with such skill.
No, let's say that we stop factory farming in some way, and we manage to feed ourselves. Perhaps we need to decrease the population to be able to do that. But let's say we manage to do that, it would still be lots of creatures feeding off animal protein, even if we didn't. Would we be under an obligation to try and stop that?
I guess that's where I'd say that like natural biodiversity, like those systems are unconscious kind of thing. So encourage that. Like you need biodiversity to have as much life as possible. So encourage natural systems so that you get like as much like natural systems going, like bring in wolves, bring in lions.
I recently read a piece by someone who it reminds me of something of what you're saying, but the conclusion that this person brought, I can't find it here, it was that, look, there's something about the vegetarian, non-vegetarian distinction that doesn't, that mismatches what's at stake here, that it's well-functioning ecology, as diverse as possible, is the aim. But that means that we have to, as it were, naturalize our relation to the living-dying dichotomy.
Yeah.
And we have to take very seriously that where there's life, there's death, and death brings life. And one way it does that is through eating. Yeah.
Was that the Andrew Smith book?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, that I think is a challenge to take very seriously. If we can imagine what an ecosystem is like where this isn't going on, and what should our moral stance be with this relation to that? That's why I asked whether human consumption of meat is intrinsically worse.
Yeah.
I grant you the scale points and the suffering that our consumption is causing. But is there something especially bad about human eating other animals?
I guess the consciousness, like being aware that like animals feel pain and like all of the studies that are coming out, not all of them, but like a lot of studies are coming out showing that like animals feel more than we thought, fish feel more than we thought, plants maybe feel, and it's like, the, like you said before, like err on the side of
caution. So for me, the implication of that would be that we are equally obligated to stop other animals from imposing that kind of suffering on their fellows as we are to.
Yeah, but they're not conscious of it, so.
Well, but the ones at the receiving end, presumably, are. That's why it's a problem.
But isn't there also a very relevant question, Jerry? If, for example, fish, are they actually cognitively aware of their pain? Can you? We can't really know if they have the cognitive ability to feel pain like us.
Let me say a little bit. I'm sure you have lots to say about that too. But there's, for one thing, we tend to underestimate the enormous differences between species of fish. Right? They're just incredibly different. Mm. There's fish and there's fish.
just two types.
And of course, you know, the question you ask is a beautiful one for a philosopher, because you know what counts as a convincing demonstration that it's true or not. If you think fish don't feel pain, you can stick to that, come what may. Right? There is not going to be a case that you can't explain away. But if you're not committed, if your mind is open. You would probably find on a survey of the evidence that there's a good chance that there is something like a subjective experience of pain in many fish species. And maybe that's all you need.
I would agree, but I of course have some interest in this as I'm a trophy fisher. I usually put out most of the fish that I catch, but just to come back to that, there's a study by a Norwegian trout scientist or something, he's a biologist, who did this study where they, I think they caught 36 trouts, and they catch and release them, and they tagged them, and were trying to behavioristically see if did they experience trauma that affected them throughout their life.
Right.
But these trouts, they stayed at the same place. Some of them were caught the exact same day. And I mean, we can't see into their minds, but from their behavior, we can see at least that these trouts didn't particularly affect from being caught.
Right.
They didn't generalize from the experience. You know, they may be pretty dumb. I think there's a good case for trout not being super inventive and responsive to experience. But look, think of it this way. Once an organism gets to the point where it's moving about and it can be successful or not in continuing to move about, have other little fish babies and so on, it'll soon, I think, advance from the level where everything is completely automated to where it needs to modify its responses in relation to input. That's why it has sensory organs and so on. And so it needs to learn at some very basic level. I mean, the brain forms partly through learning. And so something like pleasure, pain, reward, aversion is going to have to come in very, very, very early in the phylogenetic development. Do they feel pain the way we do? Yeah, who knows, right? They feel things very differently. Or what it is to feel is probably quite different. But there's something going on that's strongly analogous. What's the significance of it? Hard to tell. Just like it's hard to tell for us, you know, what a happy moment is for a salmon. And it's hard to apply this particular quantification. But I think, you know, just taking a naturalistic view of us and other species, it would be odd if something as very basic as pleasure, pain, learning wasn't vastly distributed through the animal kingdom.
Do you want to add anything on that?
That sounded great.
Then I think we'll end the talk with that. Thanks for great questions, and I think we should give Bjørn Torgrim Ramberg a big applause. And also a big applause to Tyler Doggett, coming here all the way from Vermont. We are extremely thankful, and we actually drove here straight from the airport. So thank you for coming. And before we end, I want to add that the next next event in from hosting by Kulturutvalget is the student parliament debate on the coming Wednesday, and also the next event by Akademisk Forspill, this which has hosted this event, will be What is Consciousness next Friday.
You better come.
We'll be back.
Okay. And if you'd like to host an event like this, please talk to me or some of the bartenders, or inquire to our Facebook page or webpage.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you guys very much.